Alright, so this game wasn't something I wanted to sink my teeth into personally last year, but it ended up being one of the most requested titles from you folks. This is Hollow Knight, a game made possible by Team Cherry and a successful Kickstarter to help cover the costs. To my knowledge, I think it's Team Cherry's only title at the moment, but considering it's already got merchandise available on the Eddie and Fangamer, I'd assume it's been a pretty successful debut. While technically released in 2017, the game has had several quality of life updates and free content expansions released over the last year and a half to keep things relatively fresh. The last of these, titled Godmaster, was released in August of 2018, so now the game is about as complete as you can get, and then some. There's no better time to look at it than now, I suppose. Hollow Knight was yet another one of those games I've heard in passing. I recall seeing it in a few sizzle reels when it was making its way to home console, and I remember thinking the art style was cute, but I didn't give it much more thought than that. But thanks to a combination of you guys and recommendations from close friends, and after learning it was a Metroidvania, something I've been known to have a perpetual hard-on for, I finally decided to give it a run. And once again, I'll be playing it off the PC, though from what I hear, every version of the game runs practically the same, so it's all preference. So what's my final verdict of Hollow Knight? Let's dig in and find out. I'd give a warning for plot spoilers, but Hollow Knight is very much one of those open-ended tales, not unlike, say, Axiom Verge and Dark Souls. And I know I said the dreaded D word, but it helps to paint a picture of what the game is like. Moving on. There's a basis for Hollow Knight's setup and its world, but what substance you achieve relies solely on how much you explore and what you can gather from environmental set pieces, NPCs, and boss battles. Wouldn't say it's overly metaphorical, but it's not strictly cut and dry either. Open to interpretation sort of thing. You should know how that goes at this point. From what I can gather, and I apologize if this sounds like a very rudimentary synopsis to all you Hollow Knight fans out there, you control this cute little knight that doesn't have a name as far as I'm aware, and your mission is to explore Hollow Nest, a vast region of numerous interconnecting areas that has definitely seen better days. Seriously, this place is not only inherently bleak, but it's also suffering from a rapidly spreading infection that threatens to corrupt and destroy what little there is left. Apparently, in the olden days, there was this great worm that died off and reincarnated into this pale king that wanted to rule over Hollow Nest, but some folks were already worshipping something called the Radiant, and from what I can tell, this led to a giant scuffle. The pale king made this great kingdom, but the Radiant slowly started to infest the inhabitants' dreams and slowly caused madness to spread. The pale king, in an attempt to control the infection, sealed it away inside this giant temple protected by the three dreamers. Now, this ended up slowing down the infection tremendously, but it's still sort of there and it's growing. As the knight, I guess it's up to us to directly confront the source of the infection, which involves locating the three dreamers, but I stress, the game makes it clear that it isn't that simple. There's way more nuance to be had in this world, its people, and even the knight itself, but while you have a mission, you're not sure of your purpose. The knight itself doesn't speak, doesn't emote, doesn't really react to anything, they are just an extension of yourself, so again, the story that's here is largely what you make from it. So, for me personally, well, I guess you can call me an unflinching sentinel that loves to sightsee. I want to know more about the world, so I'll do what it takes to see more of it. Now, whether that means cutting down whatever stands in my way, or helping out someone in need, or getting assistance from one of the locals, whatever happens is my choice to make, and I commit to it. And let me say, yeesh! Yeah, Hollow Knight isn't the most optimistic game out there, narratively and visually speaking, but unlike other games I played, I hesitate to label it as nihilistic and depressing. It's more mysterious than anything else, with just a handful of breadcrumbs placed to help glue whatever is truly going on here together. But while everything around looks positively fucked, the game still manages to have a sense of humor and personality. There's a lot of dark comedy to be had here, from boss fights, certain scenarios, and the numerous NPCs you can encounter. Some are well-meaning, probably to instill a sense of hope, and that's always nice, but others can be jaded, and greedy, simple-minded, skeevy, or just straight-up assholes like Zote here. The thing is, though, this world, this sticky, icky, shit-infested cesspool, is their home, and I guess this is everyday life for them, so a lot of time is not so much spent on how the end days are coming, but more like, hey, I noticed you've been buying a lot of these, so I'm jacking up the price. The story's there, but the world is the most interesting thing to come from it, and damn is there a lot to go around. I played a lot of Metroidvanias, but this right here is easily one of the biggest I've played in a long time. It took me over 26 hours to complete it, and there were still a couple of things I ended up not doing. Namely the Godmaster stuff, because it's just a glorified collection of boss rushes with different stipulations. A good time sink at least, but not, oh my god, must play. Hollow Nest as a world is massive. There's not only a large selection of major areas, but every locale also has a handful of sub-areas that have their own environmental hazards and gimmicks. To be upfront now, I found it a little overwhelming at first. Like, this is a seriously explorative Metroidvania, and they want you to get immersed in this shit. I could tell that right off the bat because Hollow Knight decides to be a little cumbersome with its map feature. Well, to start, you have to purchase maps from this dude here named Cornifer. The rates are generally cheap, but his maps only cover a general area, to put that generously. The rest of the map, which ends up about being 80% of it most of the time, has to be mapped out yourself, so I'm wondering why the knight never gets the idea to bring their own charts and make the maps themselves when they're already sort of doing that. You have to hold down the map button if you want to look at it, meaning you have to pause frequently, and there's no mini map on the screen at all to help see where you are in real time. But that's not all, you can only update the map by sitting
breathing and rest areas. Dark Souls had bonfires, this game has benches. And hey, you can't beat a good bench when you really gotta sit down, so I'm down with that. Until you sit on a bench, you're just a floating icon in a massive void, unaware of where you're going or where you just came from. Oh, but wait, you don't even have that little icon on the map unless you buy a compass from this lady, which also has to be properly equipped if you even want to use the damn thing. Yeah, this is a game they want you to get lost in. They want you to soak in all the delicious bug juices and just say fuck it, so that maybe, you know, one day you don't need to buy a map and compass and that you can just recognize these areas by heart. That's swell and all, but two things. Like I said, there are a lot of fucking areas in this game. It's like Super Metroid and Castlevania Symphony of the Night rolled into one. It's a lot to process. And a couple of times as I was exploring these areas for the first time without the map just yet, I ended up stumbling upon sub area after sub area. And since I'm the type of guy who doesn't like venturing into new areas until I explore everything I can from the previous area, I found myself stopping and backtracking all the time because who knows, I might find something in this area that'll help make the next area easier to deal with. And I realized that's more of a personal issue, not necessarily the game's fault. But don't go heading into this thinking it's like Metroid. I'm damn sure about 3 hours of my total game time was just me observing my map and planning a course, and I felt that necessary because, immersion or not, this game's palette is muted. The environmental details are second to none, and I adore the hand-drawn look from the locales, the NPCs, the bosses. This game is gorgeously animated and my kind of 2D adventure. Color palette is a different thing. This world is miserable and it shows. There's rarely a time where there's more than three colors on the screen. It's great for atmosphere, terrible for exploration. Okay, terrible is a strong word, but a lot of areas looked so alike for me, with the exception to say the green path or the queen's garden. I only knew I was in some place like the resting grounds or the royal waterway because the map told me so. To the game's credit, it certainly becomes easier to digest once you get the feel for it, which I would always hope would be the case, and once you start unlocking stag stations for quick travel, the world slowly begins to feel like one entity instead of several. And to help you along your quest, you got those classic movement upgrades that you'll eventually find to make traveling super fluid. And stop me if you've heard these before, an air dash to cover additional ground and help avoid enemy attacks, a basic double jump to reach higher areas, a wall jump for pretty much the same thing, a ground stomp to break open hidden passageways, and a super dash that looks cool as hell, but it's not quite the shine spark from Metroid. You can't really damage enemies with it, so I only recommend using it in higher altitudes, otherwise you're taking an enemy when you inevitably smack into a goon at Mach 2. The knight doesn't have much immediately at their disposal. You got the snail, which you swing around like a sword, very Ninja Gaiden I thought, but you can also swing directly downward or upwards, which is ideal for those annoying flying enemies. You can even parry certain attacks, or bounce off things like a pogo stick, which not only keeps you off the ground for added safety, but also makes it an effective way of traveling through certain obstacles. As far as close ranged weapons go though, the nail is all you got. You can upgrade it at least, and that extra damage is sure to come in handy. But if you were expecting to get other swords with more, you know, pizzazz to them, that isn't the case here. But you can also get some magical options here too. You can soon get a fireball that's pretty reliable, I found, and makes for a decent long range option that's also packing a decent amount of strength. You can also get a more powerful ground pound and this shriek attack, but I didn't find much use for them besides unlocking other things. Your other source of offense and defense comes in the form of these charms. These are things you can equip for added perks, assuming you got the proper number of notches they acquire, and some of them, I mean, damn, they require a lot. But additional notches can be found if you look hard enough, and there's even this lady who can sell more to you when you got enough money. Charms are what make or break you in this game. Some make you stronger, some increase your range, the amount of mana you spend on magical attacks, how much you heal. When it comes to combat and survival, what you get out of it mainly relies on the combination of charms you can cook up. Maybe you'd like to be overly reckless and focus on strength. Maybe you like to stay away and be a magic user, or have minions do your bidding. Maybe you like to play it super defensively and focus on healing. Whatever your playstyle, there's likely a charm combination for that, and while you have to find that particular charm first, yes, the large quantity gives you plenty of options early, and I love that the game gives you those options. However, you can only equip and unequip charms when you're parked on a bench, meaning that whatever you decide to go with, you're dedicated to it until you either find another bench or die and get sent back to your last safe area. And I don't understand how that works from within the game's world. I don't, maybe the knight doesn't want to be seen playing with their charm collection out in public. It could be as embarrassing as a stamp collection, maybe. Whatever the case, though I find it a little odd, it does add a layer of strategy to both combat and exploration. What's a good combination for getting through this next area? That's something you have to consider before heading out, because you don't want to find yourself backtracking because you forgot to equip charms, and you don't want to die because, well, it just wastes time altogether. This is definitely most prevalent in boss battles, and in Hollow Knight, there's a shitload of them. Hollow Knight is up there in terms of difficulty. If you want a tough Metroidvania, I mean, here you go. You're quite capable, especially with charms, but enemies, especially boss fights, can be just as formidable. While some are large and in charge and hit like trucks, others are small and awfully nimble. Your reaction time needs to be on point, your aim needs to be precise, and getting hit can be tremendously costly. There are no dedicated healing items in Hollow Knight. Assuming you're not resting on a bench or in a hot spring, that I think there's only about three from what I can remember, the only way you can restore health is by using focus, which requires that you stand still for a second and have enough mana in your meter here to spend. Now, getting mana isn't difficult at all. There's even some charms that make it super easy to obtain, but you primarily collect mana by striking enemies with your nail. Yes, I did state earlier that you can play this super defensively, but at some point, you have to go in for the kill for the sake of not only moving things along, yeah, but you gotta build up your mana for future use. You want more fireballs or minions? Well, you gotta get down and dirty. This results in amazingly fast-paced battles that never drag and are super satisfying to overcome. Defeating some of these guys feels like winning the lottery. A scratch-off ticket, because nothing will ever beat actually winning $1 million. Boss battles ended up being one of the main reasons why I kept going. I wanted to see how else the game could challenge me, given how fun I found most of them to be, which, I don't know, I found sort of odd yet refreshing. I still enjoyed exploring every area, and once I started getting more movement utility, that feeling extended twofold. I have certain expectations when it comes to my kind of Metroidvania. One that can satisfy that craving of exploring a cool open world, a world that can tell a good story, whether it's through cutscenes or its environment. Most importantly, among everything else, can that game be fun while experiencing all of it? A good Metroidvania to me has all of those qualities, and Hollow Knight? Okay, so the story's there, but not exactly engaging, and the world is fun to explore, but asks for a bit more than what these kind of games usually entail given its sheer size. But the fun I had fighting things and the sense of accomplishment I felt overcoming the challenge, whether it be the boss battles or maybe a rigorous platforming obstacle, Hollow Knight's challenge was enough to make up for what I thought it lacked in other areas. As a result, I ended up playing quite a bit of this game. My final rating was 104% with over 26 hours of playtime. I collected all those cute little grubs because I liked seeing them happy, except when they weren't cute little grubs, fuck you, Team Cherry. I collected just about every charm, I got all the health upgrades, the mana upgrades, I did that stupidly tense delicate flower quest where I had to take this godforsaken thing across several areas without taking damage in the slightest. I shouldn't eat in the damn thing, insects do that, right? I encountered all those optional warriors and their tougher dream counterparts, my favorite being the Dung Defender because I love how boisterous he is. Totally made me forget that I was literally in a heap of shit during the battle. I did the Grim Troop quest, I fucking loved the battle against Grim, though I ended up not defeating his optional nightmare equivalent. I just couldn't get a consistent reading on him given how blisteringly fast he moved. I played enough of the game to unlock those hidden areas, got a couple of endings, and I even did that optional Path of Pain bullshit where the game suddenly wanted to become Super Meat Boy. Oh, I did it because I fucking hate myself, but I persevered and came out on top, although looking back, I just did that shit for myself because what does it matter to you guys if I completed it for the sake of this video? You know, unless I become absolutely enamored with the game to not realize how much time I put into it, I generally don't find it necessary to fully complete a game to recommend it on this channel. Last week after I talked about Celeste, a few of you said I forgot to mention the optional seaside challenges, and guys, it's not that I forgot, it's just that I didn't find it necessary to bring them up, given that I was already strongly recommending the game with what it offered in normal play. The reason I bring up what I did for Hollow Knight here is because in this kind of game, it's the things you do gameplay-wise that make up the journey. That's mainly because I didn't find the story as is all too intriguing, I'm aware, but what can I say, when a game goes for a minimalistic means of storytelling, I gotta fill the gap somehow. You can do the bare essentials and beat the game in a weekend if that's your style, or you can spend days if not weeks exploring every nook and cranny and seeing what's beyond the next door, and as I've shown, there's a lot to do, and I found a lot of it fun and fulfilling. You're getting your money's worth, and then some, and it's not even a fully priced game, it's only 15 bucks. All that said, I probably won't be revisiting this for a bit given that its large world asks for more than I like to invest in a Metroidvania in a given time. Basically the same reason why I would play A Link to the Past over Ocarina at time, but regardless, Hollow Knight is worth your time. Just make sure you got plenty of that, should you go all out.
But good lord, do we have a couple of interesting weeks ahead of us. I mean, Resident Evil 2 Remake is one thing, Kingdom Hearts 3 is right around the corner after that, and there's still a couple of videos I want to do on top of that. Why is January and February so front-loaded? Whew. Well, one step at a time, as always. I'll catch you guys in the next video. With all that said, thank you all for watching. Have yourselves a fantastic night, and take care. No, but seriously, why the hell is there so much coming out all at once? I can only divert my attention among different games for so long. First world problems. Anyway, those who have been wondering about my Twitch archives, I got announcements coming for you soon, so be sure to tune in for that. Catch you guys later.